Welcome to the Dynamic CRM 2011 Customizations Workshop. Our agenda for today is to take a look at the customizations you can do within Dynamic CRM. Things like form customizations, view customizations, entity relationships, and things that you can do out of the box without having to be a developer. So why customize CRM? Many companies have different business needs, different industries or verticals that they need to customize a system for. So CRM meets those needs by being extendable, having the ability to create new entities, new attributes, allowing you to build those relationships between different entities within the system that helps you automate and really track all your business needs. So some types of customizations you can do within the system: customizing the application, like the forms, having multiple forms, being able to have one group of users see one set of data on the form while another set of users will see a different subset of fields, really tailors it to that user so that you get better user adoption. Creating different views to see the data within the system or different charts to really show the BI aspect of CRM, being able to really visualize your data. Adding relationships between entities, so you could have new entities or new tables that are created that you want to store information, but you want to relate them back to some existing data within the system. So having the ability to do that is key. Customizing the schema, like I mentioned, creating new entities, new views, new relationships, all that, you know, allows CRM to be highly customized. And then for those developers, you know, there is ways to extend the application even further with JScript, so doing some event programming, extending the application with .NET, more use of Silverlight options as well. So having that ability to define different logic through code that, to really meet your business needs. Also being able to modify the ribbon, so adding new buttons or hiding buttons that you don't want users to click on. So having that functionality within CRM. So as we look at form customizations, and we'll get into a demo here in a little bit to kind of go through some of these customizations, but looking at the form, you know, I can add tabs, sections, and fields to a form. So I can arrange the form to how I want it to be displayed. And like I mentioned, you can have multiple forms, so only certain groups of users or certain users with certain roles see the right forms. I can modify field properties, change their labels, their layout options, remove items off the form, and basically modifying the security of the form. So I can tie certain security roles to the form, and then those users with those security roles could see that form. And you could have users that see multiple forms, so they could select between which form they want to view. View customizations. Views are a type of save query, so they return you a list of records for that given entity that you're on. So you could have a view that says, give me all my contacts that are in North Dakota, and then that'll return in that view. Views will typically display a subset of data, and so the more you can refine your views, the better performance and the better user experience you'll see within the system. And so there's system views that you can create as an admin that all users see. But then there's also personal views. So as users working in the system, they may have a need to see certain data in a way that other users don't need to see it. So maybe I want to see all my accounts in North Dakota. Well, I could create a query for that and save it as a view, and now I have access to that view anytime I want. I can even set that as my default view, so every time I go to my accounts, that's the view it goes to. But since it's my view, no one else sees it, and I can just use that myself. As we look at a view is kind of basically made up of two different criteria. We have the filter criteria, and then we have what columns you want to display. So the filter criteria is what's going to filter out the data that you want to see. So give me all my accounts in a certain state. The columns are what columns within the system do you want to see when that view returns. I want to see account name, account number, city, state, zip. I can put all those in the view to display. Entity relationships. So if you look at the different types of relationships you can have between the entities in the system, and when I say entities, I'm kind of talking about like accounts or contacts, opportunities, or a custom entity you create. So one-to-many relationships, many-to-one or many-to-many. So those are the three of the different types you can choose when you're creating a relationship. But you also can have a self-referential relationship. And a good example out of the box is account and sub-account. So I have accounts that are underneath an account. So you can create that same hierarchy with your custom entities or other entities in the system. And then as you're creating those relationships, there is relationship behavior that you can modify as well. So for example, parental cascading means if I have an account and it's related to one of my custom entities, and if I delete that account, it'll cascade down and delete all the records that are tied to it. So if you want that behavior, you can do the parental cascade all. Otherwise, there's referential restrict delete. So referential would be, it will just break that relationship between the two records. Referential restrict delete means you can't delete the account until that child record is deleted. And then there's one additional option, configurable cascading, where you can really define what options you want to happen when you delete, when you assign, when you reparent. So we'll take a look at some of those options in the demo here too in a little bit. Then a little bit on the application event programming. So within Dynamics CRM, there's a number of events you can trigger on. So like an on load, on save, on change. Those three types of events can trigger some JScript to run, so you can automate some of the processes, or verify a certain field is filled in, or the structure of that field, or the format of the field is right. Different things like that you can do with JScript. You basically can store your JScript code in the web resources. So basically, if you have some code that is used in multiple places within the application, you could store that once and just reference it on many different forms or entities within the system. And then client extensions. So being able to create additional ribbon buttons within the ribbon menu and have those buttons flow down to the Outlook client. Creating menu items, configuring what URL they point to, modifying the sitemap. So the left navigation side, you can rename, get rid of some areas, just really tailor the application to meet your needs so you don't have extra stuff that you don't need to click on or have your users click on. It really helps drive user adoption. And then the other option is linking Dynamics CRM to other applications. So the CRM forms are URL addressable, so you can call out to other systems, have systems call into CRM, or basically reference the form URL to link to directly to that record. Just having different options like that within the system really makes it easy to extend the CRM application to other areas. The other thing to think of too is the iframe functionality. So being able to pull in data or a web page from an external site, pulling that into CRM to display that information within the system. So let's go ahead and we'll jump into the demo and we'll just kind of go through some of the scenarios or options you have when customizing Dynamics CRM. So here I am logged into my CRM organization. But before I do any customizations, the first thing I want to do is actually change the prefix on my customizations that I'll be creating. So in order to do that, I'm going to go to Settings, Customizations, and then I'm going to go over to the Publishers. By default, there's a default publisher created for you when you have a new organization. And the default for your prefix is new. So anytime you create a new entity or a new field, the word new is going to be prefixed on that naming. So in order to avoid conflicts with other, maybe you might be importing solutions from another environment that may have the same naming, or bringing something in from the marketplace and importing it, it's best practice to kind of update this to be something unique to your organization. So in this case, I'm just going to put AWC, since that's the abbreviation of the organization I'm logged in as. And then the option value prefix is going to auto-generate for you, so that'll hopefully help any conflicts of importing different option sets or pick list values. Having this number schema should help reduce those conflicts. And then you can see down here the naming prefix now will be AWC underscore and then whatever name we give the field or entity that we create. So I'm just going to go ahead and save and close that. Now that that's saved, let's go ahead and go over to the customization area. I'm going to click on Customize the System. And in my scenario here, I'm going to create a new entity, because what I want to do is I want to actually track properties. So I manage or sell or own properties, and I want to be able to track them within CRM, and then I want to link them to my contacts. So my contacts are the people living at my properties. And so we're going to go through a scenario where we set up a new properties entity, and then we will tie that back to the contacts, and then we'll see how that looks when we're done. So to start out with, to create that new entity, I'm just going to go ahead and click on my entities here. And here, if I expand it, I see a list of all the entities that are in the system. But just selecting the high level entities here, I have a new option. So I go and click on new. When I click on new here, I'm just going to type in property, and I'll type in the plural name. And then you can see, where do you want this to be displayed? So for now, I'm just going to have it displayed on the sales area. And I'll go ahead and hit save here. So while this is being created, notice there are some other options you can tie into your new entities you create. So if we want notes to be available on the entity, if we want activities, I probably could have unchecked both of those. But for now, we'll just leave those on there. The key thing to note is once you create a new entity, you can't change the notes, activities, or connections. So you have to make a decision before you create it. Otherwise, you have to recreate that entity. One new feature in 2011 is being able to make a custom entity emailable. So by selecting this option, it'll create an email address field for me on that entity. And now I'll be able to actually send email to records on this new entity if I wanted to. And as you go down here, you see there's more options for like document management. That's like with SharePoint integration. I can make this new entity available for queues. I can enable duplicate detection and auditing. And then there's also mobile express options if I want to have this entity available on my mobile express devices. Now that we have this new entity created, we're going to go ahead and create some fields because I need to track some information about my properties. So I'm just going to go ahead and click on new. And here I need the address. We'll just do single line of text there. And I'm going to hit save and new, and then we'll just do state as well. And state will be an option set. So with an option set, as I come in here and choose the option set, I can create new list values right from here. But if I wanted to, maybe if I create a state option set, maybe I want to reuse that state throughout other entities. So what you actually can do is instead of creating a new one right here, if we just click on yes, use an existing option set, I can select from a list of what's in the system already or any custom ones I've created. And I haven't created any custom ones yet. So let's just go ahead and click new. This allows me to create a new, what we call global option set. We'll just call it state. And we'll add, I'll just add a couple here just for California. All right, so now I have three option sets. And you notice the value it gave them. Part of this came from the prefix that we saw automatically get generated when we changed our prefix name back at the beginning. So this is kind of where that comes into play. So I'm just going to save and close. And now that I have that global option set created, I now see that in the list of available. So if I create other fields on other entities, I can reuse this state pick list field here. And I could choose to assign a default option if I want, but I'm going to leave that unassigned. The other option I have is, since this is a custom field, I can actually turn on field security on custom fields in the system. So if I wanted to, maybe this field is only available for certain users who have permissions to see this field, I could enable field level security on that and control those permissions. But for now, I'm just going to go ahead and save and close. Now that we've created the fields, let's go ahead and add those fields to the form. So if I click on forms, I see I have two forms here. I have my main and my mobile. I'll go ahead and just open up the main. And here I have my new fields that were just added. So address and state. And there's some additional fields that get created for you out of the box when you create the new entities. So they're created by, modified by. So we could bring those in as well. One nice thing too is if you need to create new fields, you don't necessarily have to go back to that fields area. You can create some fields on the fly right from here and insert those into the form as well. I also have some options here on the form as we're looking at the form customizations here for header. So if I click the header, I can pull in fields from the header. So, and I can reuse fields. So maybe I want to pull in the name field on the header, more additional information I can throw in there. Also the footer, so we have footer customizations available. You can drag fields into the footer. And then if we look at the navigation, so the left-hand navigation. So maybe on this entities, I'm not going to have any workflows or dialogues. So maybe I want to just remove this so they don't even show up and don't confuse users. So I can actually remove these values. And maybe I'm not going to turn on auditing, so I'm going to remove auditing as well. And I guess I'm not going to have connections either, so I'll remove that. So I can actually remove all the items. Another thing I can do too is if I hit change properties, I can rename the columns that are in the left-hand navigation. But if I hit on the form properties, I can even choose to remove the left hand. So I can say remove the navigation items. And that'll actually collapse that navigation section so I won't actually even see it anymore. Yeah, so that'll collapse the next time we, or basically when we publish it and then look at it in CRM. So those are some of the main customizations you can do. We can also insert other information. So if we go to the insert tab, we can insert different sections, different tabs. We can insert a subgrid. So what a subgrid would be is if I wanted to show related information on my form here. So for example, we have a bunch of contacts that live at this property. I could display a subgrid of those contacts right on the form here. So if I go ahead and click add new subgrid, we'll just call them, these are the tenants. And then we'll just say we only want to show related records. And this will come from contacts. So actually, since we don't have the relationship set up with contacts yet, let's back up and do that first. So I'm gonna save and close this. Now if I come down here on the left hand side, I can choose a relationship type. So one property record could have many contacts, because they're an example of apartment building. So I want to create a one-to-many relationship with contacts. So here I'm just gonna go ahead and click on new one-to-many. And here I get an option, it defaults in the property entity since that's the entity I'm on. But here I can come in and say, I want contact. It's like contact. And then the display name will be primary property. What's gonna happen is it's gonna put a field on my contact entity called primary property, and then we can fill that in with what property that contact or tenant is living at. So I'm gonna hit save and close. And as you see, there's a number of relationships that get created out of the box when you create the new entity. So if I just go back into mine that we created for a second, I'll just kind of show one thing I forgot to mention, is the relationship behavior. So this is where we talked about in the slides. You can have parental, referential restrict delete, or configurable cascading. If you choose configurable cascading, this is where you have individual options for assign, share, unshare, reparent, delete, and merge. You can choose how you want the system to behave during any of these events. In my case, I'm just gonna do referential, so like if I delete a contact or I delete the property, it's just gonna break the link. We'll save and close that. And now if we go back up to the form, I'm gonna open up my main form again here. And now let's go ahead and actually insert that subgrid. Call it tenants. And we'll say only related records, and now we should have the option for contacts. And we'll default view be the active contacts. So we'll basically show any contacts for that property. And if you scroll down here a little bit further, you can have, if you're gonna have a lot of contacts that could be tied to that property, you could display a search box in case you need to search for them, or the index at the bottom, like the ABC alphabet index, or the jump bar as some refer to it as. And then you also can have a view selector. So right now it's just going to default to the active contacts view, but I can actually come in here and say, I want to show all views so people can select different views, or I only want to choose a few views. Maybe I want to have active contacts and I want to have, the my contacts. That way you can choose between just those two views. And then there's an additional option where you can actually display a chart instead of the actual record. So I could display either just the list view or just the chart view, or I could display both. So I'm going to hit OK, and now we have our subgrid in our form. So I'm going to go ahead and save and close this. Now I'm going to go over to my contact entity, because we should have a new field over here now. I'm going to go to the contact form and open up the main form here. And here we should find our primary property. I'm going to drag that onto the contact form now. And I'll go ahead and save this. And I'll publish it so our form is published. Close that. And then if we scroll down this list here, our new property entity shows up in this list now that we created. And so I'm just going to go ahead and select it, and I'm going to publish it. So we have, all right, so now with that published, so let's go ahead and go over to our CRM system here. I'm just gonna hit F5 to refresh. Because one thing, once you publish, you're gonna want to refresh your screen so it can pull in some of those customizations. So you see now we have the properties entity that shows up here. If I click on it, obviously I don't have any records yet. So let's just go ahead and create a new record. Just create an apartment, and we can give it, and we'll go ahead and save this. And so right now, I don't have any contacts tied to this, but if I select my subgrid here, notice I have the option, I can add new contacts, add existing. So same functionality you would see within the system. So if I click add existing contacts, I can see a list of my current contacts. Let's just go ahead and select a couple. Click OK. And now they show up in this list. Now I can see who's living at this apartment. I'll save and close. Let's go over to the contact area. And so the same thing here. Now if I open up Jim here, who we just tied to the Dakota West apartments, you can see now that he's listed there. So if we went to another record here, open up Robert here, I can then now go ahead and tie him to that apartment, or I could create another one on the fly too. So save and close, and now you see how easy it is to really create lookups and relationships together. To now I can tie two entities within the system together. If I go back over to properties and open up the one that we had created, notice I don't have the left-hand bar anymore because we turned that off. If I turn that back on, we would have contacts over here where I could click on contacts and see a list. But since we added the subgrid, that's taking its place and not having to have that left nav. So it's more of a simpler form for the end user. And I can bring in the notes too if I want to have notes. Okay, so let's go back to the customization area. We talked a little bit about multiple forms during the slides. So let's go ahead and take a look at that. So here I have my main form. What I can do is I can modify the form, I can assign security roles to it. So if I click on security roles here, since I only have one form, all the security roles in the system are tied to this one form. What I can do here is, I'm just going to cancel, we'll open up the main form and hit save as. When we hit save as, we can give this form another name. And so now I have two forms. Let's go ahead and save and close. I could modify that one, but now you see I have two forms. And so I can go to the security roles here, and maybe I only want my salesperson, anyone with a salesperson role to see that, or system administrator or system customizer. So I can pick certain roles. And there is this notion of a enable fallback form. You need to have one fallback form. That way if someone logs in, if for some reason their role isn't tied to any of the forms, it'll fall back to the fallback form. So it'll just default back to that. That way the user won't get an error. They'll at least be able to see that form and use the records in the system. So now with multiple forms here, let's go ahead, I'll just show you. Let's go ahead and publish this. Let's actually do one more thing. Let's open up. I'm gonna bring that left navigation back in again. This form. All right, so let's go back out to our properties entity. Now if I open up this apartment record again, now notice at the top, kind of top left here, I have a drop down. If I hit that drop down, now I can get to my other form. And so right now that other form doesn't have that left navigation bar. That's why I wanted to add it back, because here's a kind of an example of it. I don't have that left navigation bar, so I can't switch my form back to the other form. So if I'm a user and I have access to multiple forms, the only way to switch it is if that left navigation bar is there. Close this. So now back in the customization area, the one other thing you can do now that we have multiple forms, is choose the form order. So I can choose, do I want to change the form order for the main forms or the mobile forms? So in our case, we'll do the main. And then I can choose between the two here, which one should be the default. So whichever one's at the top will be the one it defaults to. So if I'm a user that has access to multiple forms, the first one that it'll default to will be the one that's at the top. However, if I change the one I'm viewing, it will remember that. The system will remember which form I used last. So if I go back into a record, it'll go back to that same form I was just on. And so that is kind of something that's kept in memory while you have your IE session. Once you close that session, it should default back to the main top form. So the next thing we can do then, now that we have some custom forms, we have some new entities, we can create some custom views. So when you create a new entity, some views are created for you automatically. So I mean, you could go in to them and you can modify, you know, what field you want to see. So since we added some new fields, since then maybe you want to bring those in. So we'll bring in the address, we'll bring in the state, and then you can move those around on the view. If I double click on them, you know, maybe some fields are going to be longer, so I want to increase the width of them so they show up better. Then I can save this. The other option I have too is once I have a view down that I like, or I have the columns on there, I can just hit save as and save this as a different name. That way I can just kind of reuse the view that's already there as far as the fields, and then I can just go ahead and change the filter criteria. So if I look at the filter criteria, since I picked the active properties view, it just has one criteria of status equals active. Well, here I can also then pull in some additional criteria. So maybe state equals, and we can pull in one of our states, click OK. And I also configure sorting on the view. So how should the view list the data once it displays? So right now it's going to sort it by name, save and close. So now I have a couple views that are created in the system as well. Once you create a view, you will need to publish in order for those views to show up. And these are system views when they're created here. And so any user in the system would be able to see those views. One last thing I want to show you here. We're not going to get too much into creating charts, but when you create a new entity or even looking at existing entities, you can come into here and create system charts. And so if I click on new, I could come in here and maybe I want to have a chart that shows me the number of buildings by state, the number of apartments or properties by state. So I can say, you know, name, just count all. So I want to count all the records, but I'm going to group them by state. And so since right now I only have one record, it's only going to show one, but now you kind of get an idea that you can quickly have a chart that shows this information. And we can change to, you know, bar chart if we want. That way, I'll save and close this. And let's publish those changes real quick. All right, so now if I go back over to sales and I go to the properties, on the right-hand side is where you'll see the chart. So you can pull in the chart pane. And so now the chart that we just created is available. So as we create new records, let's just create one new record here. Now the chart will refresh and it shows to you. The other thing you can do with charts is once you start getting a lot of data in the system, you could use the charts to help filter down. So if I click on, you know, California here, notice how it filters my left-hand side down to just that one record that I selected. So those were just some examples of the types of customizations you could do within CRM without having to be a developer. And I want to thank you for attending today's workshop.